Today I'll be talking about the diver's ear, and of course I'm partial to this subject because it is a reoccurring theme in my practice. It is the most frequent diving injury that I see among novice divers, and I also see it among flyers, and stewardess, the diving public and the flying public seem to be the most interested in ear equalization. A part of the problem is due to misunderstandings of anatomy. A lot of people have a difficult time clearing, but they don't quite understand why. So I'm going to be talking today about middle ear equalization under pressure. I've been diving for 30 years and here in Seattle as a physician in family practice for 20 years. The topic that we're talking about, this middle ear damage, doctors call it barotrauma. And the main reason I found this topic so interesting is because it really is a preventable injury. And when we send novice divers into the pool, when we try to teach diving to students, oftentimes they go in the water, put on their dive gear, and that's when they find out that they have trouble equalizing. So my approach is something different. My approach is to try to identify the individuals who are going to have problems and to try to teach them some skills before they injure their ears rather than after the fact. I've recognized as a syndrome over the years, and that syndrome I have coined ear fear. It's a condition where a novice diver or a student comes into my office and they're not quite sure how to equalize. In fact, they're not quite sure they like the sensation. They want to dive and they want to get their ears to equalize, but when you tell them how to do it, they wrinkle up their nose and they say, oh, I don't think I want to do that. Well, part of what we're going to do today is to recognize ear fear and say there must be a way to help these people to equalize without the fear of injuring their ears. And along those lines, I'm going to address 8 different methods of equalization. So we'll cover the gamut of both passive and active methods for pressurization. You know, this anatomy of the middle ear is well known, and it was first described by an anatomist back in the 1500s. Bartolomeo Eustachio. Well, it doesn't really matter whether you call his tube the Eustachian tube or the Eustachian tube. These are just considered to be synonymous. This tube, and I'd like to go now to a model here. The tube is a variable patency. The Eustachian tube starts in the back of the throat and goes into the middle ear, and this tube was designed by Mother Nature to ventilate the middle ear, to allow pressures to equalize across the eardrum. Starting from the outside, you have the external ear, external auditory canal, the eardrum or tympanic membrane, and the famous ossicles, the hammer, anvil, and stirrup of the middle ear. We'll take a little closer look at those later. But those bones attach to the cochlea, the hearing apparatus of the ear. And the reason the eardrum works so finely is because it is allowed to vibrate in the middle ear, and air is supposed to be present on both sides, and there's not supposed to be a big gradient across this eardrum. But when you dive, of course, water pressure tries to push the eardrum back into the ear. So you get more and more pressure pushing the eardrum in, and equalization takes place when you somehow manage to get air up the Eustachian tube into the middle ear to balance the pressures across the membrane. If that balance occurs, feels comfortable, diving is okay. But if the balance doesn't occur, if pressurization continues from the outside, then the eardrum gets pulled over the ossicles, pulled over the malleus, the little bone here that attaches to the eardrum, and that's when you start to get a little tear in the tissues. Well, you can get a big tear. You can get blood in the eardrum and blood in the middle ear. And so that becomes a problem for the diver. So I meant to mention that the Eustachian tube has variable patency. Some individuals have a wide open Eustachian tube and they just have to move their jaw or perhaps blow into their mask a little bit and and air will easily flow up the Eustachian tube, balance the pressures, and so you see many divers who can descend effortlessly without any trouble. On the other hand, there are people at the other end of the spectrum with a very small Eustachian tube. Perhaps this bone is a bit more prominent, perhaps their facial anatomy a little different, but for whatever reason, the Eustachian tube has this problem where air doesn't flow easily in all individuals. I see probably 10% of the diving public having problems occasionally with diving. Now I'd like to show you what the normal ear looks like. This is a picture of my daughter's eardrum, and we took it the other day. It shows beautiful anatomy. In fact, you can't even really see the eardrum very well. It looks like a saran wrap draped across the malleus. And this is a malleus, or the hammer of the eardrum, and this little bone here, the lateral process. Medical students learn to identify the anatomy of the middle ear. Up here you can even see a little nerve draped across here called the corda tympani. This is one of the nerves that goes on to innervate the face. The bones of the middle ear go up and then back down again. This is the incus, the other side of the incus as it comes down, and the stapes goes back into the cochlea. So you can imagine that you can just barely see the stapes going back that way. In this view, you can even see what's called the round window niche. This is where one of the membranes that's attached to the cochlea sits. You can see, you barely see a dark area right here. So only 14-year-olds have eardrums that look like this. Here's what a normal Puget Sound diver's ear looks like. What you see is a person who's been exposed to cold water for many years, and folks like this develop exostoses, or little lumps in their ear canals. This is not dangerous. These lumps just look funny when you look at them in the otoscope. Now, here we have a problem that I hope you never face, and this is, of course, hemotympanum, or a bloody eardrum. What you're seeing here is an eardrum that's been damaged by water pressure pushing against it very hard, and blood is now accumulating behind the eardrum, and of course it's now ruptured out through a small hole in the eardrum, which you can't see here, and is draining right out the ear. Now, this hurts, and it takes 2 weeks or more, sometimes more, to get back to normal. Sometimes a diver who's had a ruptured eardrum will have hearing loss too, so we want to try to make sure that this doesn't happen. With a milder grade of barotrauma, instead of blood, what happens is you'll develop blister fluid here in the middle ear. Now, the blister fluid can barely be, I think you can pick out here on the screen, bubbles that are forming in this fluid, which doctors call an effusion. And during the process of Valsalva, when you pressurize your ears, these bubbles can be seen to grow. And so this little bubble right here on the top has ballooned into a larger bubble when you pressurize. So what I'd like to do now is show you this tool that I use in the office, not only for diagnosis, but to help teach people how to equalize. And again, I'd like to call on my daughter to sit here, and we'll go to a live demonstration of the ear drum. Let me know if this hurts, okay? So here we go. This is the ant's eye view of the ear. As you can see, you can identify. I forgot to take my pointer in hand. You can identify the same anatomy that we were just talking about. Here's the malleus. This little part here is called the umbo, the malleus, the short process or the lateral process. And this is a flexible part of the eardrum up here, the pars flaccida. You can barely see a dark area right here, which is the round window niche. The incus and the stapes right here. Now, Melissa, why don't you plug your nose and pressurize your middle ear. Watch the eardrum now. Okay. And so what she just did is moved pressure, thank you, moved some pressure into the eardrum. There's another volunteer here somewhere, the diver. As you plug your nose and blow, air goes up that Eustachian tube and into the middle ear. Have a seat. Now, you were just diving, I think, right?
Yeah, I just got certified this week. Was in the pool Monday and Tuesday, open dive Wednesday, Thursday, and Saturday. And I've had trouble being able to get the water out of my ears.
So. Okay. So, a new diver, you've been diving, 3 days? And what is this ear, what does your left ear feel like?
Well, when you go to equalize, I mean, I can feel the water moving in and out. If I go to equalize, it squeaks.
So you've got a little squeaking sensation.
Yeah.
Well, come over here. Let's take a look at this ear. This eardrum has been traumatized. And as you can see, we've got fresh blood in a distribution right along near where the malleus and the eardrum join. This fresh blood is caused, this bruise on the tympanic membrane, is caused by the force of the water pressure pushing the eardrum in and tearing little capillaries right across there. And that, of course, that causes a little dilation of blood vessels here. Now, why don't you try to equalize once for me? Pressurize your middle ear. Let's see what happens. I want to blow a little harder. Okay. So it's not really clearing very well for you, is it?
No.
Okay.
This one does.
Okay. Well, that's probably the reason that you injured that ear is because that's tighter on that side. Did you find that when you were flying that ear would clear more slowly or not?
Yeah. And even driving like up in the mountains.
Okay. So, thank you very much. Okay, I'd like to go back now to our slides, but this is a very important history. Student diver here has a history of one ear being slightly more difficult to clear, slightly tighter than the other side. Now, often you'll get this from students But again, until now, we haven't had a tool, we haven't had a method in which we could teach the diver a more positive way of equalizing. And so that's what I want to do now. I'd like to concentrate for a moment on how we're able to learn about this stuff. You know, the anatomy of the middle ear I talked about was described many years ago in the 1500s. But this Eustachian tube is only surrounded by bone part way down toward the throat. The bottom part of the Eustachian tube is surrounded by cartilage. And muscle is attached to it as well. So the common sensation of crackling in your ears when you swallow is because these muscles, the levator muscles of the soft palate, tug on these Eustachian tubes. So we'll be talking more about how swallowing and how movement of the muscles in the back of the throat affect the patency. And in fact, you'll learn to put traction on those muscles. The ear fear I talked about before is an important syndrome to recognize, because we know some people find middle ear pressurization uncomfortable, and some of these folks have had bad ear problems as a child. Occasionally, you'll get a person who describes a sensation where air blows retrograde back up the tear duct and fizzes or bubbles out of one of the tear ducts. And that's, it tickles, or it's an uncomfortable sensation. And people aren't really sure whether that's dangerous to you to do or not. So there's also, we as diving instructors also create some confusion by telling our new divers not to blow too hard. You don't want to blow too hard or you'll hurt your ears. Well, that instruction to a person with tight Eustachian tubes is confusing. It makes it difficult for someone to figure out just exactly how hard to blow. These are some of the techniques we'll be talking about: the Valsalva maneuver, the Toynbee maneuver, the Frenzel, this one, this French method here, the voluntary tubal opening, and some combination techniques as well. The Valsalva maneuver is probably the easiest maneuver to learn. Most people have an intuitive sense of how to do this. That's plugging your nose, increasing the pressure in your chest, cheeks tight, and this maneuver is like a strain, like straining in the chest, like that. Well, it shouldn't really be a very prolonged maneuver, and this is where divers get into trouble, especially if a new diver has ear fear and is a little squeamish about pressurization. They'll start very slowly, and they'll build up pressure in their chest very slowly, and what happens is there a lot of vessels in the head become engorged, and it can inhibit venous return to the heart. So the Valsalva maneuver is great if you do it quickly and if it's a nice sharp oomph, but if it's done slowly, it can make you feel dizzy. It can make you feel odd. So the Valsalva maneuver is not one that I teach right off. And of course, you never want to do a pressurization technique on ascent when you're diving, because that can lead to pulmonary problems. The method I like the best was first identified by this colonel in the German Air Force and the Luftwaffe, who used to teach his dive bomber pilots how to pressurize when they're making bombing runs. And I call it the throat piston, because that's what you do with your tongue. And you raise up the tongue with the glottis, with the vocal cords closed, and with your nostrils pinched, you bob your Adam's apple. So I'm going to do this for you right now, and I want you to watch if you can see my see my Adam's apple bobbing up and down at the same time that my nose is inflating a little bit? Here goes. Pretty hard to see in the back, but what my Adam's apple is going up and down because my whole larynx and my tongue is moving up and down. That's creating a piston effect, pushing air right back into my ear, into my middle ears. Later on, we'll show you that in the with the video otoscope. So that's the Frenzel maneuver. The advantages are that you can do this during any phase of respiration. It doesn't have to be with a full chest. You can plug your nose and blow anytime. It does not affect the venous return to the heart, and can be performed with your mouth open, like with a scuba regulator in. I call this bobbing the Adam's apple, as a way of teaching the technique, because you can see your Adam's apple moving up and down in a mirror. In fact, if I had a technique to describe, it would just be that you watch your nose and the anatomy change as you pressurize. In fact, that's what we call the Doc's technique. You watch your snaz, watch the snazola, this fleshy part of your nose, you watch it inflate, and so I'm going to, again, do that for you. Plugging the nose, you palpate the fleshy part of the nose, and you can tell how hard you're blowing by just gently feeling your nostril tissues. I want you all to do that right now for me. Plug your nose and inflate, and then feel the balloon-like effect that the pressure has on your nose. Now, if you can barely feel that, that means you're not blowing hard enough. Okay? You want your nose to inflate a little bit. So what I envisioned was all the Nowy and the Patty instructors going down the line, checking each student, yes, yes. No, this is not quite hard enough. A little bit more over here. You know, in fact, the Navy SEALs would have this, do it, you know, they're, anyway. I think that this pressurization thing is extremely important, and that's why I recommend it to all new students. Passive techniques are fine, and we'll talk about those in a minute, but passive techniques rely on skill and luck, and sometimes students don't have either one of those things. So you have to give students something that's a little more definite in pressurization. Now, for the individual who has a hard time getting it, who can't blow hard enough to pressurize their ears, their middle ears, I've put together some very low-tech equipment here. I don't know if you can see this or not, but this is a 10cc syringe with a finger caught on the end of it. And this is my piccolo. Here's the bassoon, which is the 20cc syringe. And for big noses like mine, you have the bazooka. This is the 60cc syringe. Now, what you want to do with this for the person who has trouble equalizing is you have them put this in their nose and voila, instant pressurization. Well, if they don't get it when you tell them blow harder, you make them a little bazooka and you have them blow hard, and it does take a little bit more pressure to blow up this finger to one of my exam gloves. But the point is that there must be a dozen ways to teach people how to pressurize. And we're not using any of them right now. So I want to bring home this message, and that's we need to do a better job teaching pressurization. Now, pressurization is not the only way to equalize. In fact, Joseph Toynbee recognized that just swallowing allowed air to move in and out of the middle ears. The swallow with the nostrils pinched caused attraction of these muscles of the soft palate to pull on the Eustachian tube. And you can even hear this crackle with a stethoscope. You can hear it in your own ears. You can hear it in other individuals too. This technique is particularly useful when you're on ascent, when you're coming up, especially if you've got a little reverse squeeze and a block of your ears and they're not off-gassing quite as well as you'd like. You can swallow, and it helps the air come out. It's a passive technique. That means that it relies on the patency of the Eustachian tube to do its work, along with the milking action of the levator muscles, the muscles that elevate the soft palate. And so I don't recommend it for students. This is another one, the BTV. This is a maneuver which Jacques Cousteau uses in the French Navy. And it involves contracting the muscles of the soft palate, this little thing in the back of the throat, and yawning, or perhaps like blowing a smoke ring. Now, I don't want you to start smoking to learn how to do this, but if you have once ever blown a smoke ring, then you kind of know what I'm talking about, this kind of maneuver. Well, Dr. Roydhouse is a sports medicine doctor from New Zealand, and he figured out that you could look at the soft palate and look at it in the mirror and practice raising it up, tilting the uvula forward, and those maneuvers coupled with a jaw thrust or movement of the tongue will put traction on the Eustachian tube. So here's another maneuver. It requires three separate muscles to contract. Raising the soft palate, tilting the uvula forward, and thrusting the tongue. It can be learned. It's not something that you want to teach a student, but it's a good way to do it for the commercial diver, for the person who's is a professional. There are a number of combination techniques, and Carl Edmonds, a physician from Australia, first identified one of these, a pressurization technique with the jaw thrust. The Lowry technique, very effective, where you use a valsalva or a swallow, a valsalva and a swallow. That means pressurize while you're swallowing. It's kind of like patting your head and rubbing your stomach. I mean, it just takes a little practice to do it, but it is possible to learn this. And so pressurize and swallow is very effective for the person with a tight Eustachian tube, or maybe just one side's a little tight. You know, there are a lot of methods, and I'd like to just spend a moment talking about these concepts, because that's my take-home message, is that there's a number of interesting things that we can carry with us to help teach other people too how to do these, how to clear your middle ears and how to protect one from diving injury. Pressurization methods definitely work best for the novice diver. When I see a diver with a problem, I tell them to swallow and yawn and pressurize at night when all the lights are out, and have them listen to the sound that your ears are making. What you're hearing is the moist membrane of this membranous canal, the Eustachian tube, popping open, and this crackle gives you the signal that you need to know that it's working. It's working right. Okay, so we're talking about an inborn method of biofeedback. When you get it right, your ears will give you an automatic feedback signal that this is the correct method. And that's what I call Eustachian tube awareness. It doesn't happen right away, but as you dive more and more, you'll begin to get a sense that your ears are doing what they're supposed to. Well, this new student doesn't have Eustachian tube awareness, and so they need to practice these techniques at night, at home, when no other distractions are around, to get a better sense that their ears are ready to withstand pressurization. I always tell my new divers to pressurize on the surface before they begin a descent. Before you begin your descent, so that you're putting a pillow of air behind the eardrum, and that air pressure is supporting the Eustachian tube as the water pressure continues to try to deform the eardrum inward. The sport diving community will tell new divers to pressurize early and often. But what does that really mean? I mean, how early and how often? Often means continuously in my book. You want to keep the pressure all the way on your ears until you've reached the bottom. How hard do you blow? In a diver who has already gotten 10 feet underwater and who's having an ear problem, the answer is don't blow at all. We don't want people to blow hard when they're underwater and their ears are blocked. If you get too deep, you're not going to be able to equalize. And if you blow hard, what happens is you get a big thrust of air come charging up this up the Eustachian tube, and it snaps the membrane. It snaps the tympanic membrane, and it snaps the round window here in the cochlea, and that can lead to trauma. That can lead to damage. It can lead to a ruptured eardrum. So we don't like people to pressurize when they're already blocked up. But when you're on the surface, you can pressurize vigorously. You can plug your nose and blow as hard as you want, and that will not cause trauma to your middle ears. We also don't want individuals to pressurize on ascent. Again, that is a technique which can lead to pulmonary damage, and so that's not a good way to learn techniques. My caution is particularly extended to musicians, because if a musician injures their ear, they can lose valuable frequency response, and learning how to equalize should protect a musician from inner ear damage. That's damage to the cochlea, to the hearing organ. If you do have a high frequency hearing loss like I do, well, it's harder to have that competitive edge. It's harder to be to play in the symphony, because you can't get the tones just right. So if you're on a vacation and you've flown to the Bahamas and you injure your ears on the first day there, it takes 2 weeks for that trauma to resolve. So oftentimes we'll have people with trauma to their ears who lose a better part of a diving vacation. Muffling of hearing means that there's something wrong with with the middle ears, and not something that you should ignore. It could be blood and it could be fluid in the middle ear. So the take-home message is that divers have trouble with technique and not anatomy. For 99% of the time, when I see a new diver in the office, they are just having trouble learning the technique which allows them to dive. I can't tell you how many times I've seen an individual who believes that they can't scuba dive because they can't get the air to equalize in their ears, and it's just a matter of learning the proper technique. So my motto is, never give up. There's always a way, and I work with these individuals to help get the pressure to equalize. It helps if you've got a highly motivated individual, because that's what I'm going to ask them to do, is practice, practice, practice. We do have treatable problems, and the treatable problems can be a big impediment to diving. If a person has allergies, that can make your ears quite stuffy, quite difficult to equalize. You can have trouble getting air in and out of your the sinuses as well. And so treatment of allergies is important. The common cold, we'll talk about it in a minute. I don't recommend that individuals dive when they have a cold, and that's because it does cause more frequent barotrauma. Sinus infections, nasal polyps, these are all things that a physician can help divers with. Deviations in the nasal septum can sometimes dry out the mucous membranes in the back of the throat, and that can cause additional problems. And of course, pregnancy can result in some congestion. We don't recommend it that pregnant women dive anyway, but often a pregnant woman will be a little stuffy from the extra fluid that she carries with her. And so there's a lot of reasons not to dive. A pregnant woman has a greater risk for injury of the fetus, so that's the main reason we don't want pregnant women to dive. But they get congested, and that's another problem too. So the common cold is sometimes deceiving, because symptoms appear to be mild, but when you dive and tweak your ears a little bit, you get a much more congested response. And so what I see is that reverse block or ear trauma on ascent, people coming up will have more problems than during a cold. And divers always want to know if it's okay to use decongestants. I think, again, that technique is more important than decongestants, and I would always stress that if you know how to equalize, you're going to be able to do what you need to do without drugs. For the faintest amount of congestion, there isn't any problem with Sudafed, there's no problem with Afarin, but I've seen some dive clubs around talking about the use of steroids and other more aggressive medications to help control middle ear congestion. And I think you can go overboard when you're talking about treatment strategies. So in summary, I've talked about ear fear, and I think you know now that ear fear is just the trepidation that a person has when they first learn a new technique and they discover some sensations in their body that they're not quite comfortable with. So ear fear is not a reason to cancel your dive classes, but it is something that I think we have to recognize, because those people are at greater risk for injuring their ears. When you lay down at night and you swallow at night when all the lights are out, listen for that crackle and pop in your ears, because that's the sound of the levator muscles tugging on your eustachian tube, and that's the membrane popping open a little bit. And you can hear that same sound at the end of a yawn. And after a while, you can play with these muscles and learn to manipulate your eustachian tube at will. We talked about watching the schnoz. That's my technique. And I want you to look in the mirror when you squeeze your nose and practice bobbing your Adam's apple, because that technique will help you to offer aid to other divers who are having trouble. And of course, what I'd like to see is people pre-pressurize all the time. pre-pressurize, pressurize on the surface, and continue to pre-pressurize until you get to the bottom. When you're at the bottom on a dive, that's when you equalize. That's when you move your jaw around and let that extra pressure come out. If you're looking for information and you'd like to know more about the diver's ear, there's an article on my website, and I've posted it here. I'm with the University of Washington, as you knew from our opening comments, and on the website is this article which you can use to teach techniques to other people. If any of you were dive masters here, I would encourage you to take these methods with you and to spread the word about middle ear pressurization. Before we begin a feedback session, I wanted to show you a bit a bit more of middle ear anatomy. And so what I'm going to do now is switch back to live video and use the scope to demonstrate the Frenzel maneuver. Now, my eardrum doesn't look like my daughter's. It doesn't look quite as clear. And that's what happens when you get to be 50. You know, you get your eardrum gets a bit foggy. But there's nothing wrong with that eardrum. Works just fine. Here goes. You see that this membrane on the top here is the pars flaccida. It's not supported by quite as much structural tissue as the pars tensa is. And so you'll see much more movement in the top of the tympanic membrane. If I switch over to the other side, you can see where we have a bit of ear canal trauma. You see that right there? That's what happens when you use a Q-tip on your ears. You see a little red spot developing. And again, we'll go through pressurization. And so you can get quite a bit of control there. Now what I'd like to do is get some more real-time cases. Any other divers in here who would like to take a look at their ears? Okay, please come up one at a time. Now, this is an interesting part of the program because you never know what you're going to get. Come on up.
I always have problems clearing my right ear, and on a dive a while ago, I think I did exactly what you said not to do with when you're 10 feet down at the blow, and I felt a big shift. And since then, I have that, what you were saying earlier about air coming out your eye.
The retrograde flow of air through your eyes.
That's not a bad thing.
Uh-huh. Okay. Well, let's take a look. Now, be sure to tell me if I hurt you here now. Okay. You never know what you're going to see. And so here, what we have is a normal amount of wax. You see a little bit of this normal canal accumulations here, sometimes more, sometimes less. But this is the malleus and the lateral process. The eardrum is all this tissue here. And now, why don't you plug your nose and inflate your middle ear? Okay. Well, gee, did that sound clear and crisp to you?
It's kind of crunchy.
Kind of crunchy, okay. Well, I don't really see any fluid to build up behind the middle ear. There is no blood accumulations along the malleus, and so whatever happened before seems like a relatively minor problem. I'm glad that didn't injure yourself severely. Now, you don't seem to have too much trouble moving air in and out of your ears.
No, I'm usually okay with it, but I think I was stuffy that day.
You were stuffy that day. Okay. All right. Well, let's pass the baton.
I'm getting nausea. I've had, in two recent experiences, I've come up spitting blood and bleeding through the nose, and I'm feeling water getting in my left ear, and I'm getting nauseous on every dive, like down at 35 feet, all of a sudden getting nauseous and vomiting as soon as I get up to the surface.
My goodness, that takes some of the enjoyment away from a dive.
When you're in a wreck and you have to throw up at 35 feet, it's like the British say, it's
okay.
A bit of a sticky wicket.
You would be surprised how many people have these ongoing problems, and these are treatable problems. Remember now, 99%, 95%, something like that, of people have problems that can be corrected by just perfection of their technique. So be sure and tell me if I hurt you now, okay? Now we will see some wax in some of these ears, and that's normal. That wax is a normal accumulation, and so some people have a bit more than others. It depends on how much hair is in the external canal. Mother Nature put that wax there to protect your ears from moisture. So again, don't be afraid of wax. Now, here's your eardrum, and why don't you? It's a little foggy, so let me wipe let me just warm up this.
I clean my ears every morning. They're wax machines.
Uh-huh. Okay, that's a little more clear. And so go ahead and pressurize your middle ear for me now. Let's just see what happens. Can you, there you go. Okay. Now, was that easy to do or was that hard?
Hard.
Okay. Let me see how hard you were blowing. Okay. Now, in your case, what I want you to do is I want you to put your fingers on my nose now. Go ahead. Okay.
Yep.
I'm blowing a little harder than you are,
yep.
Right?
Yep.
Now, so that's watch the schnoz is the way we do this. Okay. Now, now I'm going to have you blow a little harder for me, just like I was. There you go. See, now, that's the difference between getting a more forceful pressurization. Was that uncomfortable for you to do?
No.
Okay. How about your other ear? Is it okay, too?
Yeah.
Okay, great. Well, I think we ought to give you the bazooka to take home so you can practice. Okay. On to the next. And why don't you tell me a little bit about your ears and why you've had a problem.
Well, equalization is challenging for me, but I can always get it, usually the first 30, 40 feet. But my problem are the next few days, I just feel, I call it like my ear hangover, diving hangover. My ears just feel stuffy.
Stuffy. Right.
And they pop, and after 3 or 4 days, I'm usually back to normal. But
well, you know, that's an interesting sensation. The reason it's there is because when you squeeze the tissues of your middle ear, that causes a bogginess to occur in the mucous membrane. The mucous membrane is a little bit edematous, or edema is the word doctors use for being swollen. So the tissues of the middle ear become swollen. They leak a little fluid. This is that blister fluid or exudate that doctors refer to. And sometimes that fluid will sit there in the eustachian tube and in the middle ear, and it'll crackle for a couple of days after a dive. That's the signal that you've been squeezing your ears during the dive. Now we have to try to figure out why that's happening to you. I'm going to warm up this tip again because it fogs up on me, and that's what this bath is all about. Okay, taking a look, external canal, a normal amount of wax. Now, the eardrum here looks a little different. This little shaggy stuff here is probably just some wax that's pasted on the eardrum. It isn't dangerous, but it's harder to see your malleus. It doesn't look as crystal clear as the others have. Why don't you try pressurizing for me? Plug your nose. There you go. Did that hurt to do?
No.
No. Okay. So what you've got is a foggy, somewhat milky eardrum, and that probably means that that there's been some torque and tension across it. I bet if you start pressurizing earlier, pre-pressurizing and keeping the pressure on your ears all the way down, there might be a better chance for you to get there without trauma. Have you tried that? What technique do you use?
Everything I can. You know, the pressure, the tongue back and forth.
Okay. Show me how to bob your Adam's apple. Plug your nose and let's... Okay. Well, your Adam's apple's bobbing, but air is not flowing into your nose. So we still have to work on that. So when you get home, you want to watch your nose, try to inflate it by bobbing the Adam's apple. And I bet that technique will work better for you.
I did have a lot of ear problems as a child.
Uh-huh.
So.
I do see individuals who've had problems as a child having a little bit more trouble. Thank you. Why don't you tell me what is wrong?
I had ear problems as a child. I've been motion sick my whole life. I have trouble equalizing, but I usually can. But the thing that disturbs me the most is the last couple of times I've dived, I've had really bad vertigo attacks.
And oh.
That's sort of been very unpleasant. And then they've reoccurred subsequently a week or two after
I
went
see.
Diving.
Do you have one ear that will equalize or easier than another?
I couldn't tell you. Sometimes it may be one, sometimes it may be the other. I don't have one that I feel is.
Okay. When does the vertigo? Vertigo means, of course, means a very intense dizziness. And when does that vertigo occur? Is it in the middle of a dive or when you come up?
No, it's in the middle of a dive. I will have gotten pressurized. I'm down there. I'm loving the view. And then all of a sudden, bam.
Whammo, huh?
Yeah.
Okay, well, let's take a look. We'll do one side at a time. Be sure and tell me if I hurt you, okay? Now, I always say that because sometimes the little tip on this will dig into the external canal. So here we see what looks like normal eardrum. There's, again, the eardrum and the malleus, and you can't quite see through it. Why don't you try pressurizing for me. Inflate your mitt. There we go. That wasn't hard to do. Did the other side pressurize as
yeah.
well? Okay. Let's try again. Pressurize. Okay. Well, right now everything's working just fine. But when I hear about people who have problems with vertigo at depth, it usually means that one side is pressurizing and the other side is not. We call that alternobaric vertigo, and the cochlea, the semicircular canal, doesn't like it. When one side's pressurized and the other isn't, or one side has cold water and the other doesn't, the asymmetry of the signal to the brain will confuse your balance and it makes you spin around. And so, again, this is a problem which I believe is related to equalization effort. And I bet if you tried pressurizing more earlier and more aggressively on the way down, it's possible that you can get rid of this. So there are other problems that can occur. And if that doesn't work, why don't you call me? Okay? You've been a wonderful audience, and I've enjoyed this. Not only a hobby, but it's something I use in my practice every day to help divers learn how to protect their ears. And I just want to say thank you for coming today and visit my website, and thank you very much.